to welcome His Highness Prince Turki Faisal Asaud, well known to everyone in this room as a former Director General of Saudi Intelligence, and most importantly to me, the Saudi Ambassador to Washington in his illustrious past. Prince Turki has very generously offered to provide some observations of his own on the conversation that ensues with our panelists, and he will do so just before he has to leave around 3 o'clock. And Hussein, I will leave that to you to introduce His Highness at the appropriate moment.
Specifically, we're going to look at two angles, American politics and policy on the one hand, and its impact on U.S.-Saudi relations and U.S. relations with the Gulf states in general. We're delighted to have a very distinguished panel with us today. We welcome, right next to me, David Frum, senior editor at The Atlantic. And if you want to know more about the panelists, their bios are in the little pamphlet on your seat. But very briefly, David Frum is a senior editor at The Atlantic and writes for a number of other publications, Daily Beast and others. We have, again, to my immediate right, Professor Bernard Haykel, extremely distinguished scholar of the Middle East, who is professor of Near East Studies at Princeton University. And at the end of the table, Mr. Fahad Nazer, who is a non-resident fellow here at the Arab Gulf States Institute in Washington. And I am Hussein Ibish, a senior resident scholar here at AGSIW. So we're going to have a conversation about JASTA. Just before 3 o'clock, we will ask for some thoughts from His Highness, and then when that's done, we will open the floor up to you and have your comments and questions, and we'll wrap up just around 4 o'clock. So that's how this is going to proceed. And I'll begin by asking the panel their initial thoughts, but let me just say that on September 28th of this year, Congress handed President Obama the first and what will probably be the only veto override of his administration. So it's really very significant. And it required a piece of legislation of enormous emotional and political power to prompt that. And not only was it the only veto override of the Obama presidency, look how lopsided the vote was, right? Only one vote to sustain the veto in the Senate, Harry Reid, the minority leader, who is retiring, right? And in the House, 77 members voted to sustain the veto. It's absolutely overwhelming. Before that, JASTA had passed with unanimous voice votes, not to say that everyone voted for it, but no one voted against it at all during these voice votes. So it's a tremendously one-sided piece of legislation. But on the very day that it passed, September 28th, when the veto was overridden, 28 of the senators who voted to override the veto sent a letter, an open letter, to the sponsors of the legislation expressing deep concern about the consequences of the very act they just voted for, and were immediately talking about the need for a legislative fix. So this is all very extraordinary and not normal at all. So let's begin by taking a look at the impact of this bill, which basically allows Americans to sue foreign governments and foreign governmental officials for acts of terrorism that have taken the lives of U.S. citizens on U.S. soil. It's very specific. And it doesn't contain the usual kind of binding executive waiver. We'll talk a bit about what it does allow the executive to try to do. But let's begin with an overview. And let me ask Professor Haykel to begin by giving us your sense of the impact of this bill on U.S.-Saudi relations in particular, and any other major impact you think it's going to have on American diplomacy. But let's focus on the Saudi angle first.
Okay, thank you, Hussein. I think that this bill is, in a way, a culmination of a series of events that had already indicated to the Saudi leadership that things were not going well in the relationship. And more specifically, that the Obama administration had, in a way, abandoned its allies in the region. And Saudi Arabia is not the only ally that feels this way. Israel also, I think, feels this way. In favor of a more pro-Iranian, or at least the Obama administration, of course, sees it as a kind of balancing act. And this legislation seemed to be the icing or the cherry on the cake that culminated this process. The Saudis, Saudi leadership, sees this as not only unwarranted, but as not being based on facts. That the that Saudi Arabia had been and continues to be at war with both Al Qaeda and more recently ISIS. That there is a long history of antagonism and actual blood in that relationship. And so to be accused of being to be accused of being culpable of doing something you have not done strikes the Saudis as unjust and unfair. And I can say something about the relationship between Al Qaeda and the Saudis if you wish me to.
Absolutely, go right ahead.
From what I can tell, at least as far as the Saudi leadership is concerned, is, you know, to say that you know, you want to blame us for something we did, that's mm-hmm. fine. But if you want to blame us for something we did not mm-hmm. do, that's not fine. I mean, no one would accept this.
Mm-hmm.
And the analysis, I think, sees this as, one, the fact that the Obama administration did not do enough to improve the relationship, and certainly didn't do enough when the override was being, you know, the process for the override after the veto, that the administration didn't do enough there as it had done, for instance, mm. when the legislation on Iran was being considered
mm-hmm.
By Congress. This is a relationship that needs to be fixed, and also the leadership in Saudi Arabia sees this all as a function of a particular electoral cycle in the United States. That mm. had we been in a time when there weren't elections and very strange elections,
mm. Yes.
then this probably would not have happened.
Mm.
As maybe I should get back to the issue of the relationship with Al Qaeda in a later question.
Sure. No, well, we'll definitely be talking about that a good deal. Before I bring in the other panelists, let me do a quick follow-up to you specifically. Yesterday, I think it was, Secretary Kerry, after meeting with the Saudi Foreign Minister, Adel Jubeir, had a very interesting comment, and I'm just going to quote him verbatim because I think we need to consider the language very carefully and therefore precisely. He said that... we discussed ways, we meaning the two foreign ministers, discussed ways to try to fix this in a way that respects and honors the needs and rights of the victims of 9/11, but at the same time does not expose American troops and American partners and American individuals who may be involved in another country to the potential of a lawsuit for those activities. So what could the United States and Saudi Arabia do bilaterally at the executive level to address this? I mean, in other words, is there something pending the legislative fix that Congress is talking about? And we'll discuss all of that after the election. Is there anything in the interim, until there is a legislative fix, that U.S. and Saudi Arabia can do to either offset the impact of JASTA or maybe set the stage for a fix, if you see what I mean? In other words, sort of do something that gives Congress the ability to say, well, we don't need JASTA as we passed it. Something else will do because these steps have been taken.
I mean, there has been an idea of setting up a fund for the victims of 9/11, but I can't imagine, nor would I think anyone expect the Saudis to be engaged in this, because it would assume that there's culpability there.
Mm-hmm.
The thing to understand about the victims of 9/11, and of which, by the way, I mean, I was there when 9/11 happened. My neighbor's son was killed in the buildings. I saw the buildings go down. So, you know, all of us were touched on that day.
Mm-hmm.
The thing, though, that I think the victims must understand is that Osama bin Laden, in person, wanted to drive a wedge between Saudi Arabia and the United States. The fact that there were 15 of the 19 hijackers were Saudis is not an accident. This is a deliberate, he waited an extra period of time to find the sufficient number of Saudis to actually join this this attack. So if you destroy the relationship with Saudi Arabia, you're actually fulfilling his last will and testament from his watery grave.
Mm-hmm.
Why would you do that? I mean, why would anyone want to do what bin Laden wants to be done? I mean, I think it's not just a rhetorical question.
No,
I think
it's a good
question.
Yeah, it's a very serious question, yeah. Fahad, let me ask you the same question. I mean, what do you think can be done between now and additional legislation to offset the negative impact of JASTA at every level?
Right, so obviously that bill came out of Congress and it was vetoed in Congress, so the ultimate resolution will have to come out of Congress. It's difficult to say, like Professor Haykel, what tools are available to either the Saudi government or the administration. However, I do want to point to the immediate reaction of the veto or the override of the bill, because I think there was a distinction between the relatively measured response of the official response of the Saudi government and then what you saw in the Saudi media. So the response from officials, whether it was Foreign Minister Adel Jaber, was fairly measured. I mean, the way that the Saudi officials have framed this issue all along was very similar, in fact, to the way that the administration has framed it, that this has wider repercussions for the way that nations conduct their international relations, that you have this organizing principle without which chaos could easily ensue. The Crown Prince, Prince Mohammed bin Nayef, made sure to also make a similar point when he addressed the United Nations early in the month. So that's the official, that has been the official response. Obviously, that they've expressed grave concern, but it's been relatively measured. And when I say relatively, I'm talking about in comparison to what you see in the Saudi media. And
right.
In the Saudi media, the response has been much stronger. And when I say media, I'm talking about both traditional and social. So my reading is a lot of writers have seen this as basically adding insult to injury, and they framed it in the wider context of relations with the Obama administration over the past 8 years. I think if you read the Saudi media, President Obama's legacy is clearly not viewed very positively. And I think it began with his reversal on the self-imposed red line on Syria. The nuclear agreement with Iran created further tensions. And this, I think, too, again, in the eyes of many Saudi writers and opinion leaders and just regular Saudis online, was seen as adding, adding insult to injury. They thought that over the course of these 8 years, the Obama administration has simply not appreciated the value of this relationship, has not appreciated the history that goes back to many decades, that has not appreciated the fact that the two countries have actually fought a war together in the early 1990s and fighting essentially a war, a different kind of war against al-Qaeda and other militants on a daily basis now. So I think there's a sense of disappointment and frustration among the Saudi public in general, and you do detect, you sense it as well in some of the statements coming from officialdom as well.
Yeah. In the media, the Saudi media response by commentators has run the gamut from very calm iterations of the that the relationship is strong and not to overreact, and there's been a lot of that. But there's been some, I would say, even hysterical responses, including 9/11 trutherism, basically implying that, well, that's, you know, there was kind of an inside job on 9/11, and pointing at American 9/11 truthers as evidence of that. And also even some people saying it's an Israeli plot and pointing out that Chuck Schumer, was one of the prime sponsors, is Jewish, which is very weird, because Israel has been quietly very opposed to this, and I think that's maybe not fully known by some of the more let's say, hyperbolic commentators. But yeah, I mean, there's clearly a lot of tension. So, David, what about the American side of this? Because I mean, it was difficult to vote against JASTA, which is why people didn't. So, can you talk about the political dynamics?
Well, you have leading to this both a change in the weather and a change in the climate.
Huh.
And the climate may be more important. The idea of sovereign immunity has been a corroding idea in American law for half a century. It begins with the civil rights movements. Remember, the states are theoretically and legally sovereign. And for 150 years, the states, so the southern states, used their sovereignty to protect their officials from doing things that would have been illegal had one private citizen done them to another, murder people.
Lynching.
As part of the civil rights laws of the 1960s punctured various exceptions in sovereign immunity that governed American states. Once you've begun doing that, from the point of view of American law, Saudi Arabia is not all that different from Alabama as a legal entity. Saudi Arabia is a sovereign, so is Alabama. And if you're in the habit of puncturing through Alabama's sovereignty claims in order to do justice, it's an easy habit. The second change in the climate has been the tendency to judicialize political problems, including international problems. And I think the rise of the International Criminal Court is a very relevant comparison to what is happening here. It didn't used to be thought a plausible or reasonable thing to do, that the way you would bring heinous international offenders to book was you try to bring them before some kind of tribunal. That we all recognize that international justice is very imperfect and it's inherently political. It's not just a matter of double standards, but of triple standards. Stalin dies in his bed, Hitler dies in the bunker, and that's not justice, that's politics. And we have become increasingly impatient with the idea of politics as the way of adjudicating international disputes. We more and more turn to judiciaries, as we have lost faith across the Western world in our institutions of representative democracy. So those are the climactic changes that I think are shaping this environment. You are appealing, as you see with Secretary Kerry's remarks, in order to explain why you'd want to have sovereign immunity, you have to come up with a lot of quite emotive arguments that do not go directly to the idea. Courts are bad places in which one sovereign should address its difficulties with another sovereign, because courts are always see one issue. Courts, their job is not to do trade-offs. You slam into my car and do a lot of damage. The fact that you are, a good husband and father is not interesting to the court. Were you driving too fast? That is the one question, and that is the way courts are constituted, and that is why we keep normally the political and the judicial realm separate. But we're unwilling to do that. The change in the weather, has to do with, as you say, the Obama administration's decreasing grip on its own on Congress and on its own people in Congress. This is not a game that the Obama administration ever liked to play, they've never been good at it. In the first 2 years, Congress frankly led the Obama administration on issues like the signature issues, the health care bill, the stimulus. Congress really wrote them with very little input from the Obama administration. They gave some very general guidelines, but they didn't really drive it the way the Bush administration drove its preferred policies, the way certainly the Reagan administration did. And in the final year, of course, all of that gets weaker. And finally, there's, of course, the change in the weather, that the Obama administration is rebasing American foreign policy, and you've both spoken brilliantly about that.
Well, thank you very much. I mean, now let me follow up with you, and then we'll bring everybody else into it. I mean, what are the chances of a legislative fix here after the election? And how far can it go? I mean, and specifically, let me put it to you like this: the sponsors of JASTA and all of their that whole constituency, led by Schumer and other very powerful people in Congress, have won a total victory, right, as of now, at least from a procedural point of view, right? There's a successful override, and this is now the law. So it's probably any fix would require people who want a total victory to compromise on that.
Right.
Why would they do? Will they do it? Why would they do it? And how can this be accomplished? You know, is appealing to the national interest enough? Can it? What can be done here on that?
Well, you've created one powerful new constituency, which is America's always hungry trial bar.
Yeah.
That's
right.
You know, we asbestos created lawyer millionaires. Tobacco created lawyer billionaires.
Yeah.
People who have the ability to sue Saudi Arabia might create lawyer multi-billionaires.
Lawyer trillionaires.
And, yeah, lawyer trillionaires. Thank you. Like Dr. Evil, why make billions when you can make trillions?
Exactly.
Or he said it the other way around, I think. So that's one powerful constituency. And it's a powerful constituency, especially since we've been making domestic changes that make this kind of litigation less lucrative inside the United States. And a lot of the traditional magnets for mega litigation, the state of Texas, they've changed their state law in ways that make trial lawyering less lucrative.
Right.
So this does offer the prospect of a gigantic payday.
Yeah, and very deep pockets.
On the other hand, what is strange about this is normally, of course, Republicans are hostile to the trial bar.
Mm-hmm.
That this was one of the things that this brought together. It was a chance for Republicans who fight with lawyers and often find in state politics the trial bar is there. If you're doing races for governors and state assemblies, the trial bar is one of the most important sources of Democratic Party financing. This is a way of redirecting a potent enemy against a target that is of not much interest to state-level Republicans.
Yeah. Yeah. So, Professor Haykel, what do you think the Saudis could do to strengthen their hand in this relationship? I mean, assuming, as I think it's fair to, that the final word on JASTA has not taken place, that more will... At least there's a potential for additional measures, and I think they're likely, actually. What can the Saudis do to maximize the outcome for their benefit?
Well, I mean...
Or what would you advise them to do?
Sorry. Right.
Yeah, that's a better way of putting it.
I mean, Saudi Arabia doesn't have a domestic American constituency,
right.
at least a direct one. But many tens of thousands of jobs in the United States depend on contracts and sales of American products to the kingdom. I think that, you know, that the relationship has an economic dimension, that the relationship has a geostrategic dimension.
Mm-hmm.
Also, the truth about how Saudi Arabia has fought Islamism should be made more prominent.
Mm-hmm.
I also think that the Saudis, frankly, have done a very poor job of telling their story in the United States.
Mm-hmm.
And I think there's no place for them to go but up, frankly, as far as the American public is concerned. So, you know, a public diplomacy, a public relations campaign, and then also, of course, very practically, there is the question of the constitutionality of this law.
Yeah, but that takes a long time to...
Yes, but...
To litigate.
It can stave off actual litigation.
Okay, so what you're suggesting is to make the case publicly and to Congress about the dubious constitutionality of this law in order to rationalize a legislative fix.
Yeah, and then you can put off actual trials for a decade.
Yeah, yeah. Fahad, what do you think the Saudis are going to do?
Well, I'd like to mention a roundtable that I attended not long ago, about 2 months ago, prior to the vote, with the Saudi Foreign Minister Adel Jaber. It was here at the Saudi Embassy with just a handful of us. Analysts from Washington, and for about 45 minutes or so, Minister Al-Jaber tried to convince me and everybody else in the room that U.S.-Saudi relations have never been stronger or in better shape, contrary to the popular perception that there's been this strain in relations. And he cited a number of examples. Economically, the size of the trade has continued to increase significantly, even going back to 10 years ago. there is very close cooperation in terms of countering the threat from militant groups, whether ISIS, Al-Qaeda, or their various branches. He mentioned the number of students who are here. And he even, at some point, he even joked, he said that you know, Secretary Kerry is in Saudi Arabia so often that he practically lives in Riyadh, which, which is... there is continuing dialogue. I mean, that is one of the striking features of the relationship, I think, is that there seems to be almost nonstop dialogue on a host of issues between the two nations. And we just saw the minister was in town yesterday and met with Secretary Kerry to talk about a host of issues. So I don't think it's an accident that this relationship has succeeded, as has been sustained for as long as it has. Like Dr. Haykel has said, I think that it is multidimensional. I think the trade is really, I think, to some extent, dismissed or not given enough weight here. There are companies that have made you know, a living and have made business in Saudi Arabia, and has its employees have made or maintained their jobs here for many years. You have thousands of Saudi students who've studied in the United States. So I think I do see this relationship ultimately surviving this. I mean, there is precedent. Sure. The 73 embargo is probably the first
strain. This is not
strain.
The lowest point.
And then there's the 9/11 attacks themselves. Mm-hmm. Now, some would argue that that relationship has not fully recovered from that. I'm not sure. I think that certainly compared to the immediate aftermath, it has, and again, I think the cooperation does exist on several fronts. Mm-hmm. So over the long term, I am, I think, optimistic for the endurance of the relationship, but there's also no denying that I think that the relationship has come under strain during a very turbulent time for the region, and I think understandably so.
Mm. Yeah, by all means.
I think... Saudi Arabia has always been a very potent player of the inside game in Washington. I speak here as someone who does not know Saudi Arabia well. I've never even visited the country, so I'm speaking, I'm sure, in terrible ignorance. But one of the things that I just think is a general rule of politics is when you've lost a round of a game, you need to change the game. And if you've having been a good inside player, this is a defeat in the inside game, and that means you now need to think about the outside game. One of the things, again, I speak in ignorance, not knowing Saudi Arabia at all well, but there are widespread American suspicions that not everything is known about the Saudi role in 9/11, including those famous redacted pages in the 9/11 report. Mm-hmm. What if Saudi Arabia convened its own 9/11 commission with internationally recognized investigators and said, we're going to open it, we're going to go through our files. I mean, obviously, every country has state secrets. But we are going to answer every because one of the things that even for those who don't like the trial lawyer lobby and understand the importance of sovereign immunity and don't want international relations judicialized, especially not with friendly countries, is the suspicion, well, what exactly did happen? Yeah. You know all the rumors, air flights out of Washington, the 23 redacted pages. Convene a commission, open your files to that commission, publish a report of the quality of the 9/11 report and say the questions are answered. To the extent that this trial process was about discovering truth, you don't need to do it because we want to face the truth.
Yeah.
And it might be, by the way, a potent, again, I caution again with knowing very little about Saudi Arabia, never having visited, it might be a potent tool in any internal debate between people who want a more forward-looking kind of politics inside Saudi Arabia and people who espouse a more reactionary kind of politics.
And it goes to Professor Haykel's idea about mobilizing the facts, right? I mean, you said, so Fahad, you had some responses.
Yeah, right? I think it'll be a difficult case to make to the Saudi leadership and the government, because I think one of the first things they'll point to is the fact that even though the various U.S. government agencies and independent commissions have already thoroughly investigated this crime, yet there are still people in the U.S. who still do not trust the results of their own, you know, American commissions' results. So why would they trust the Saudi efforts.
Well, sure, there'll be doubters, but don't you think that it's potentially that kind of thing could have a positive impact? Whether it's doable or not is not really the question that we were asking. What we were asking is, and what David's suggesting is, one potential kind of approach, right? Mm-hmm. I mean, at least in theory, it would have some positive impact, wouldn't it? Or not?
Potentially, mm-hmm. right. But I mean, 15 years after the attacks, I mean, very few. Certainly, that's been the Obama administration's position and the Bush administration's position prior to that. That this attack has been thoroughly investigated by not just a congressional committee, but mm-hmm. you had the independent 9/11 commission, and there was a more recent. Perhaps even more thorough investigation done by the intelligence community. I believe it was as recently as 2013 that took both of those prior investigations into account. So I'm not sure that anything will come out of any further, you know, investigations, whether it's Saudi Arabia who does it, that does
but
it.
But that would be the crucial thing, right, as I understood your suggestion, David, and also yours, Professor, and that it would be a Saudi gesture. There would be that's sort of the crucial thing. It's not that it would necessarily uncover a massive amount of new information, but that it would be an effort to be transparent or more open, right, on proactively.
Right. And just going back to the issue of the 28 pages, so obviously this was, a mystery for many years, and they were finally declassified. And I read them very carefully, but mm-hmm. to be honest, with all due respect to some of the analyses I've seen of some of the, the critics who still think that there is something there, I got the sense that they were playing almost a game of 6 degrees of separation, where they're trying to connect Osama bin Laden to various players mm-hmm. in Saudi Arabia. I think those of us in the audience here and elsewhere who understand Saudi Arabia, it is very easy to connect Saudis to the government because of the fact that you do have public education. You have 7 out of 10 Saudis who work for the Saudi government at some level or at some point in their careers. It is very, very easy to try to connect these dots when in reality I don't think there's any dots there. So that's just my observation.
All right. So Professor Haykel was discussing the constitutionality of the law. One of the most interesting features of it is the set of issues that arise in this context. That have to do with the relationship between the legislature and the executive, right? The judiciary is kind of a collateral beneficiary in a way, potentially, unless you think they're being put on the spot. But mm-hmm. basically, Congress has attempted to give a bunch of power regarding foreign policy decision making to not just the courts, but even the plaintiff's attorneys,
and to the jury. And the jury, ultimately.
If it ever gets there. But, I mean, as one of the interesting things about this is that for JASTA to have a negative impact or a JASTA-related lawsuit to have a negative impact, it wouldn't have to go to trial. It wouldn't even have to go to a verdict and damages. The discovery process alone would create the crisis, right? I mean, that's where the demand for secrets would come up and a diplomatic incident would be. So as soon as the trial is allowed to go ahead by a judge, then you've immediately got your crisis, But I'd like to ask David to talk for a second about the lack of an executive waiver in this bill, which is really extraordinary. It may be unique, right?
Right.
Compared to something like the Jerusalem Relocation Act or many others, where there is a binding executive waiver. And there was in earlier drafts of JASTA. It's been dropped. It was dropped. And the relative constitutionality. What this all says about the relationship between the legislative and judicial and executive branches.
Look, there's a non-trivial constitutional argument that goes to exactly what you said. Because presidents are confronted with foreign abuses of the civil rights of the rights of American citizens all the time.
Yeah.
Malaysian airliner overflies. Ukraine. Yeah. A missile from somebody shoots it down. That missile probably was supplied by the Russians. Maybe the people who fired it were the Russians. And I think I forgot, there were, I think, four Americans on that flight, and they're killed. And now the president has one more problem in the relationship, very complicated relationship with Russia. And the president has to decide, is this problem one, problem two, problem 11, problem 14? How does it rate? What if the Russians are being super cooperative on another matter at the same time? How, and that is, that's politics. That's what presidents do. And if everybody, if everybody in the world was you know, a good friend and a liberal democracy, you wouldn't need foreign foreign relations at all. But the world is full of people with whom we have very complicated relations, and the Constitution entrusts that job of balancing those concerns to the executive branch and to the president. And this clear, this does infringe on that presidential power. So I think that's a non-trivial argument. A lot will depend on what the Supreme Court looks like in a year or two.
Right.
As you all know, there's a vacant seat. Judge Garland may end up on the court in the last months of this Congress. That's not impossible. There may be an even more liberal a judge appointed by President Clinton if she makes it. Generally, the judges that Democrats like don't tend to give a lot of deference to presidential presidential power. And that may be about to change. Now the Democrats are getting so much better at winning the presidency than they used to be. But judges, remember, are old and carry around with them the ideas of 20 years ago.
Right.
And those people who would be eligible to be put on the Supreme Court by President Clinton would have their minds formed mostly during the Reagan years when the Democrats were suspicious of presidential power and it was Republicans who were advocates for it.
Let me just take a little pause here before we broaden the conversation, which I think it's a good idea to do, and bring in the audience and invite Your Highness to make a few remarks, if you would like, before you have to go at three. So if you'd like to use the handheld mic or come to the podium, I'd be very interested in getting your feedback as long as you're with us.
Thank you very much. I congratulate myself on being here and hearing the distinguished panelists, because it is a very eye-opening session, and I appreciate it, and thank you for it. I just want to read you something that I wrote and delivered at a conference before. The JASTA Act is designed to target the most faithful ally of the United States for the last 70 years. Saudi Arabia, which is the cradle of Islam and the Arab people. This law, regardless of its legal aspects of downgrading international law and state sovereignty or its worldwide implications, is directly and indirectly victimizing a victim of terrorism. Saudi Arabia is a victim of terrorism as much as the United States is, and by the same terrorist groups. By passing this act, Congress had made the evil spirits of Osama bin Laden rest in peace. Congress, by this, has accomplished the terrorist aim to hammer a wedge at the heart of U.S.-Saudi relations with all what it means to Arab and Islamic relations with the United States. The passing of the JASTA bill has sailed through both houses of Congress and will create waves through which the Saudi ship of state will steer and maintain a steady course. The relationship between our two countries is too big to fall. That it will survive this politically motivated and ill-advised conduct of the representatives of your people. This act demeans the so-called democratic process, of which your country is justifiably proud, and to which my country seeks to devise our way to achieve it. It promotes personal naked political gain by trying to camouflage it under a shroud of humanitarian aims, in contravention of the international law of nations. And the American government is sued in so many international legal jurisdictions based on this folly. Those who voted for it will rue the day. Too bad that America's commitment to the rules of international sovereignty, international sovereign immunity, is so cavalierly overturned by the people who proclaim themselves as the protectors and setters of legal norms. international justice is for the world to administer, not for national institutions. That's my view of JASTA. As you can imagine, I am angry. I am insulted. And I am saying it out loud. And what adds to me more insult to injury is to hear the present talk about rectifying JASTA by making it not applicable to Americans. This is even more of a consideration that the interests, not just of Saudi Arabia, but the rest of the world, are being totally ignored. And no rectification of that situation, I think, can take place unless and until this law is revoked. I'm not a dreamer. I don't think the law will be revoked. And I agree with Dr. Haykel that we in Saudi Arabia have been remiss, if not downright negligent, in not engaging ourselves more, not just with the United States, but on the international arena and letting people know who we are and where we come from and what affects and does not affect us. And Fahad Nazer is right in saying, I think, that we will not, in my view, consider having a commission to investigate this situation, because that has been done already. And the U.S. federal government, as well as the investigative authorities of the U.S. federal government, produce reports that have verified and assuredly factualized that Saudi Arabia had nothing to do with September 11th. And yet, there is still doubt by the people here in America or some of their representatives about the investigations undertaken by their own government. So why should they believe our government if we have that same investigation? I really don't have much more to say other than to thank you again for your very exemplary exposition of this situation.
Thank you so much. I really appreciate that. And thank you for joining us. I don't think we're finished with the conversation we're having here, but the audience that we have is so distinguished. And I see so many expert and very well-informed people here that I think we just need to bring in the audience right away. I see that there's a very, very keen, very enthusiastic gentleman, and we'll begin with you.
My question is to David. By the way, my name is Cammy Butt, and I'm with the Pakistani Spectators. Okay. David, I do not know if you have law degree, but my question is, don't you think it's a great opportunity for a Muslim immigrant like myself to sue American for their brutality? In Pakistan, not dozen, but hundred of people have been, innocent people have been killed with American drone attack.
Well, but JASTA doesn't allow that.
Okay, but see, if we allow American citizen to sue Saudi government, then people like myself should be allowed to sue American government for killing those innocent people. And given Saudi Arabia is the second most corrupt Muslim country after Pakistan, and in Muslim world, Pakistan is known, but Pakistan is known because Pakistan has no self-respect. Okay. As you know, Pakistan made millions of dollars in blood money selling their own innocent people to American
who got
free from American court system.
Fine.
So it means Muslim or Pakistani has no self-respect.
Well,
go after them and sue them and get money, whatever we could
get
from them.
Understood. We have your question. Well, that's fine. So it's specifically you, David. Yeah. So the question really is, what about Americans being sued? And it wouldn't be here. It would be, say, Pakistan making not just, it wouldn't necessarily have to be violence or terrorism. Americans could be sued for anything that another country deems unlawful.
Well, not that anyone cares, but to answer your first question, yes, I do have a law degree for my sense. I went to Harvard Law in 1987. I missed the president. If I'd played my class, who knows, right now I could be an ambassador somewhere if I'd managed to graduate in a slightly different year. without the emotion in it, your question is quite right. That is the basis of the sovereign immunity system, because we don't want the United States. I mean, I hope I won't offend your feelings. I would say very few Americans have the confidence in the Pakistani court system that you do, maybe zero. But it would happen, of course, that people would bring lawsuits. They would they would win in the Pakistani courts. The Pakistani courts would then try to attach such American assets as were present in Pakistan, and that's why sovereign immunity is a cornerstone of the international legal system. And there are lots of, I mean, when you do what the lawyers call the parade of horribles, could a German national sue the U.S. government for the carbon dioxide that is emitted by American coal plants that is regulated in Germany as a pollutant, is not regulated here as such? No, you get.
It's a very interesting question.
You get, and there are in Europe a lot of tribunals that are interested in judicializing. I mean, this is one of the reasons why those of us who were opposed to the International Criminal Court were so strenuously opposed to it. I really think that was the opening of the Pandora's box, the moment we decided to do that. And that created a possibility of inviting people to think of what were inescapably political problems as susceptible to judicial solution.
Before we take the next question, we'll go to you and then you, and I have it. But I'd like to ask Professor Haykel just for a second. There's been a lot of talk, both here and in Saudi Arabia, about the possibility of Saudi Arabia or Saudi individuals or corporations or the government or all of them divesting from American assets in order to protect them from potential verdicts and seizure and whatnot. What do you think about that?
It's actually impossible to do. Because, you know, I mean, just from a purely legal point of view, even if there wasn't a single dime here from Saudi Arabia, you could still seize airplanes. You know, there are many, it would just be a way to completely destroy the relationship, and it would be a way of acknowledging culpability, which I think the Saudis are very clear about, which is that they're not culpable. So my sense is that the Saudi government has taken a decision that this is not going to happen. Aside from the fact that it's actually very impractical and very difficult to do.
Excellent. Thanks for that. And so we're going to go to you, sir, and then to you in the back, and then we'll go on.
Abdullah Al-Hassan from the International Monetary Fund, but I ask this question as a Saudi. Following up on your questions about disinvestment, I think you mentioned, Fahad, about the local media, where they talk about the JASTA and the negative views. But there are some who went far ahead and they suggested making disinvestment from the United States.
I think
the minister, he hinted to it in the past. Personally, I don't think that will be feasible. I don't think the authority, they do need it, nor the statistic that came this morning from the Eurobond that the government issued yesterday. 44% are from United States, hedge fund, pension funds, and so forth. But I would be interested to hear your views about the outlook of the investment, whether in trade or in capital, between the two countries, and are there any negative precautions for this law?
Great question. What's the impact on trade?
I have seen I've certainly seen these calls in the Saudi media almost immediately after the veto was overridden. But these calls have been in the Saudi press for a while, especially as we saw this strain between the U.S. and Saudi Arabia over Syria and I think primarily Iran deepen. Now, what I've seen, and I don't think it's the most reputable source, it's a Saudi website of some sort, that actually it does maintain that Saudi holdings of U.S. Treasury bonds have decreased a little bit over the past year, but it's nothing dramatic. Overall, when I think it was the New York Times that actually did reveal the numbers, it's about $80 or $90 billion worth of U.S. Treasury bonds that Saudi Arabia holds, which is significantly less than many other countries. China and Japan, I believe, are at the top of that list with considerably more, but so are, I believe, Ireland and Brazil have much considerably bigger holdings. But it's also my understanding that the foreign minister, Adel Jaber, said that we did not make, there was an item in the press that there was a threat of some sort, but it's my understanding that he said we never made such a threat. What we did say is that the prospect of having our assets frozen will likely have a negative impact on the investment environment in the United States for other countries. And obviously, there are many, many countries that have even bigger investments in the U.S. than Saudi Arabia. So I think he was responding in a broader sense in terms of just making foreign countries nervous about investing in the U.S.
First, exactly on this text, why should Saudi Arabia should be afraid if it is not involved? And this is also some of them quote one of the congressmen who used the same statement. Second question, most of them wondering if there is no item or article in the U.S. Laws that to freeze the Saudi Arabia investment or money here with the beginning of the suit. So why Saudi Arabia not to take the time, because we know such kind of suit, it takes a long time to be finished. So why Saudi Arabia not to use this long time to withdraw gradually or immediately their money here?
Okay, so that's the same question again. But what I would point out two things before I ask the panelists. Number one, we come back again to that question of divestment. I don't know if there's anything any of you want to add to that, but I would say, I want to reiterate, a JASTA-related lawsuit does not have to go to trial or let alone verdict and damages to create diplomatic chaos. All it has to do is get into the earliest stage, which is discovery. Discovery, there would be interrogatory questions and demands for documents, and that would be the diplomatic crisis right there. Because essentially, plaintiff's attorneys, whose only interests are the interests of their client and who are ethically bound only to pursue zealously the interests of their clients, right, would have to essentially go for broke, so to speak, in getting as much information as they could.
And let me add something to that, which is, of course, civil matter is not a criminal matter.
Right.
There are very weak requirements of confidentiality. Mm. Anyone who has ever been a beat reporter knows that the way you get your big stories is that a local plaintiff's attorney gives you their dossier on the local factory, the local bank, and you as a journalist, you present, you end up, and usually you're in a situation where the plaintiff lawyer is more entrepreneurial, mm-hmm. the defendant lawyer is more corporate, yeah. the plaintiff lawyer makes his or her own decisions about what to reveal, the defendant lawyer has to go to a committee, so the plaintiff lawyer is always nimbler and faster and more responsive to your phone calls, and they shape your story in a way that the corporate defense lawyer never does. And when the entity being sued is not a corporation but a state, that will be even more true. And you will have a lot of partial reports. And so just to echo what Hussein said, that anyone who's ever been involved with any of these government investigations here in Washington knows the famous phrase, the process is the punishment. Even if you win.
You lose.
Yeah.
Do any of you have anything to add about investments and finances? The gentleman is specifically asking about that, and I think we've been over it a bit. But anything to add? Okay. Well, we'll move on to the next question. We have a gentleman right here, and then you after that, and then you in the back. Yeah. So we go.
I'm Patrick Theros, a retired ambassador, and I run the U.S. Qatar Business Council. I think one interesting part is this law, at least as the letter of the law is written, is not aimed at Saudi Arabia, it is aimed at the entire world.
Right.
And I worry that any number of really imaginative trial lawyers can find some really imaginative links between say, support from other Gulf countries to an organization which is another, which is linked to a second organization, which is linked to a third organization.
Mm-hmm.
Are we seeing any reaction from other countries, not just in the Gulf, but in the region? I can think of half a dozen non-Gulf countries that could be linked to some act of terrorism.
Yeah, I mean, I'll ask the panelists to answer, but let me just tell you that the EU, as a body, sent a letter to the State Department before it was passed, deploring the act and warning darkly about its consequences and what its own member states might have to do. The French have protested. I think the Dutch have protested. Believe the Belgians have. I know the Israelis have been quite strong on this, very quietly behind the scenes, and I think there are others. So the international community has been quite outspoken, and we're talking here about opposition from really key American allies, right? And so it's not necessarily just states that are on the periphery of the American alliance system, or states that are very close allies like Saudi Arabia, but that are sort of culturally distant from the United States. You know, close and long-term and culturally close allies of the United States who are very disturbed by this because of the impact they think it will have. The position they think it will force them into, I think that's the point that the French have been making, you know, is that they won't be able to restrain their own trial attorneys and others in their own system. If the Americans behave like this, their politicians will pass a law doing the same thing, and then they'll be full of magistrates and prosecutors and plaintiff's attorneys doing all kinds of things. Gentlemen?
Right, yeah, it's my understanding that the GCC did issue a statement.
They did.
Collectively, but also individually, expressing their grave concern. And as you already said, Hussein, countries like the Netherlands and France also issued very strongly worded statements. And as I mentioned in my opening remarks, that has been the argument of the official argument from Saudi officials from the start, that this has the potential to not only impact and weaken Saudi and strain U.S.-Saudi relations, but it goes way beyond that, which is, again, in tinkering with this pillar of the international order. And as David said earlier, it's basically changing the rules of the game, which I think it's very understandable that most countries don't want to do that because they're just not sure where that leads you.
Yeah, and David called the ICC Pandora's box. And the first time I wrote about JASTA, I used that metaphor for JASTA as well. I think it really is. It looks so nice. It's so attractive. But it unleashes horrors, I think, in all likelihood.
I think there's been one case against Iran based on JASTA. Yeah, I think there's one already lawsuit that's been filed.
There's one that's been filed against Saudi Arabia. I know that, by a Navy widow, 9/11 widow. So I know that for sure. There may be an Iran one as well. So that means.
You could sue Iran.
You could, definitely. I know.
You didn't need JASTA.
You're right. You're right about that.
1605A,
you're right about that. There were already lawsuits against Iran that were successful,
there are lawsuits against Saudi Arabia that were stopped because of the sovereign immunity doctrine that now will get reactivated.
Right. I mean, that's why there was this push for JASTA, is that there were quite a few lawsuits against Saudi Arabia or Saudi officials that routinely dismissed because of sovereign immunity. And the whole point of JASTA is to allow them to go through the court system and into discovery and chaos. You've asked a question already, so we have another question in the back. We'll come back to you, sir, but give other people a chance.
Thank you so much. My question, kind of a very short question. We've, of course, focused a lot of our time today on the effects that JASTA will have on the Saudi government, given the number of hijackers that were Saudi. But as I'm sure everyone knows, two of the 9/11 hijackers were from the UAE.
Right.
And I was curious if you all might want to weigh in or could weigh in on what effects JASTA will have on the UAE's government, and if so, how and why.
Yeah, and the UAE and Bahrain both lost little time in joining Saudi Arabia in making independent statements against JASTA, as well as the joint GCC one. But we'll begin with you, Professor.
Yeah, I mean, I don't know specifically how the UAE can be
involved, but let me just give you some context that I think is sort of the background to JASTA, and which is that a case has been built now over years, specifically against Saudi Arabia. Mm. That Saudi Arabia has been promoting its form of Islam throughout the world, it has been doing this for decades, and that terrorism is the result of this missionary activity. Mm. And this is very clear, for instance, in the New York Times, a newspaper that seems to have a bee in its bonnet about Saudi Arabia on this issue. And I think that that's why the focus is so much on Saudi Arabia, because you can somehow trace it to the missionary activity. My own feeling is that this intense focus on Saudi Arabia is actually driven domestically by at least two issues. Hmm. One is that I think a lot of Americans have a real issue with Islam, and have a real issue with Islam largely because of 9/11, but also because of ISIS, what they see being produced on television. And many of them don't want to say we're against Islam. So Saudi Arabia is a stand-in for that. So it's a way of sort of absolving their own conscience from having to say we're bigots against Muslims. But the problem is with Saudi Arabia. And the second reason why this argument against Saudi Arabia seems to work so well domestically is that it absolves America of all culpability in the production of the jihadi phenomenon.
Yeah,
I would urge. You don't have to approve of what Saudi Arabia has. If your case is the reason you should oppose this attack on sovereign immunity is in order to show your approval of Saudi Arabia's missionary activity, you're making a bigger mountain. You can be completely agnostic, on that question, and I think there are a lot of reasons to be concerned about Saudi Arabia's international role, and about the nature of the missionary activity that is spread not just to the United States and to Europe and Pakistan and other places. There are a lot of people who are going to have those concerns. Those are the people. It's like fighting any election. Mm-hmm. That you want to concern not the people who already love you. You don't have to spend a lot of time on them. Right. The people whose votes you have to win are the people who don't love you, and they may even have rational reasons for not loving you. But you say, okay, I understand you don't love us. This tool is going to backfire in all kinds of ways and hurt your own interests.
Yeah, I think that's right. Fahad?
Sure. I agree with Dr. Haykel. I mean, I think that the rise of ISIS and the attacks that they've actually carried out in the West has led some to look for an answer. And unfortunately, I think there's a temptation and a tendency to look for easy answers, and it does seem that for many or some at least the easy answer is Saudi Arabia and what is characterized as the ideology that it has propagated over many years. Now, people who've taken a closer look at terrorism and how people become radicalized have pretty much are all in agreement in saying that ideology is indeed a part of the equation, but it's only one part of a much bigger, much more complicated equation. Sometimes it comes at the very end of a long process. There are political, economic, and social factors that go into all of this. Now, having said all that, I think that the Saudi government has acknowledged that some of its institutions, religious institutions and educational institutions, both in Saudi Arabia and abroad, needed a closer look in terms of what was being taught at these schools, what was being preached at the mosques. I've looked into education reform myself fairly closely, and they have done a fair amount of revising the curriculum, removing some of the material that was, frankly, just intolerant, and I think that's with the acknowledgement of Saudi officials at all levels. That process is still ongoing, but I think it's come a long way. And then the other thing that they've done is they've looked at these religious institutions, certainly inside Saudi Arabia. So you are very unlikely to get an imam at a mosque somewhere that encourages people to go abroad to fight a jihad, because it's actually against Saudi law to do that now. And it's my understanding that in certain regions of Saudi Arabia, new mosques are actually required to have cameras and other recording devices. So if somebody does you know, start singing the praises of Al-Qaeda or ISIS. They get pulled aside by his by their own parishioners, maybe is not the, the right word, but by the people at their at the mosque itself. So I think they've taken a pretty hard look at religious and educational institutions, and made quite a bit of progress. But I think at the same time, I think there's more work to be done. And again, this is according to you know, Saudi officials themselves.
Well, yeah, I mean. We have the gentleman in the back, and then we're going to come to you. So, and then well, one, two, three.
Hi, thank you for this excellent presentation. I'm a securities lawyer by training. I'd like to hear your thoughts about how the Aramco going public issue could affect all of this.
Okay.
Because talk about lawsuits and talk about the issues of transparency and talk about some of the challenges that the kingdom is going to have. Just in that process and how that might segue into this other process.
Very interesting question about the impact that the potential Aramco IPO has on JASTA and JASTA lawsuits and vice versa. Any thoughts, Professor?
Well, I mean, I don't think there is actually a clear answer to that question. I mean, if Aramco, if there's an IPO of Aramco, which looks very likely, it's very likely to also happen probably in New York, maybe New York, London, and Hong Kong, but very likely in New York. And that would mean that there are all kinds of issues to do with Aramco as a sovereign entity in Saudi Arabia itself. It would have to disclose all kinds of issues about, you know, reserves and wells and things that it hasn't had to do before. Yeah. So there's that issue before we even get to JASTA. And then JASTA would, you know, would compound matters. But, you know, if you want to go after Aramco assets, I mean, you don't need the IPO. Aramco owns a huge refinery in the south, in Texas. I mean, there are lots of assets, Saudi assets, I mean, physical assets that you can go after.
Yeah. Any other thoughts? No. Okay, so right here in the front row, please. Yeah, thank you. And then...
Marwa Mazia, University of Washington. Maybe I want to bring back some of the questions about the extent and the impact of this around other GCC countries. Mm. My work is actually on Qatar in particular. Mm-hmm. And in a book that I published a couple of years ago, I was actually looking at how rumors or actual eventual allegations of the bribery in the World Cup. Mm-hmm. I was looking at how that could come into more of allegations of unlawful acquisition of assets in the very countries Qatar, for instance, had acquired assets. So I was looking at how some of these countries are treated as holdings and actual corporations. So if you can comment maybe on the legal aspect of how corporations are sued or not sued in internationally, and also that extend to other GCC countries beyond EE, the Emirates, actually, Qatar, since it didn't have its own citizens on these planes, but how much are they impacted with this?
Yeah. Would you like to begin?
I mean, I'm not a lawyer, so I, you know, I'm not going to venture.
But you're a lawyer. Do you have any thoughts on this?
Look, once you're dealing with private entities, the whole question of whose law applies to which lawsuit, that was famously the hardest question, the hardest exam in the entire three-year curriculum, because it created an infinite regress, where you were directed from the law of country A to the law of country country B.
We were joking about that on the way in.
I think that's a different kind of matter, it's not a new matter. They're vast. Volume, there are people, and there are people who devote their lives to this fascinating topic. Corporations from one country will be sued in the courts of another. That happens all the time. That's part. That is the other side of the system of international comedy that is threatened by the idea that you can actually sue the sovereign itself.
Fahad, do you have anything to add to that?
No, I'm not an expert on legal matters.
On the issue of discovery that Hussein keeps mentioning, I mean, just for those of you who are not lawyers, just to understand what that means. Mm. It means that the King of Saudi Arabia can be hauled into court in New York and interrogated by an attorney. Mm. That's what it actually means, potentially.
Among other things.
Right. So, you know, you can imagine
the problem that and if he doesn't show up, yeah. then you know
there's a high probability
you get a summary judgment against the kingdom,
and then you get immediate damages.
Correct. Right?
And there'll be punitive damages, and for punitive damages to have an impact, usually courts calculate that it is the amount has to be commensurate with the assets of the defendant, of the defendant who's lost the judgment. So if it's the Saudi government, it's going to have to be a measurable percentage of their GDP. I mean, it's a huge amounts of money potentially at stake, which is what David was talking about when we were talking about the political dynamics at work here. We're going to go to you, and then you. Yeah.
Hi, Theodore Karasik. Thank you very much for putting this together. Sure. I wanted to ask you a wider question about JASTA and the impact that JASTA will have on the National Transformation Program and ultimately Strategic Vision 2030. Yeah. I think it's important to think about those medium to long-term implications. So I wanted to hear what the distinguished panel has to say.
Yeah. What about the impact on the transformation program, if any?
Well, I mean, can I jump in? Sorry. Yeah,
please.
so I was in Saudi Arabia not long ago, and I think the that very ambitious package of economic and social reforms is really, I think, on everyone's mind. I think in some ways it will be the centerpiece of King Salman's legacy as mm-hmm. he forges it ahead. So just, I think, I don't want to diminish its importance and by calling it a nuisance, but it's definitely, I think, a distraction for the Saudis. They would much rather focus on, I think that three primary issues, I mean, the economic reforms, the Vision 2030, really is, without exaggeration, I mean, everywhere I went, that's what people talked about, because it's impacting, and it could potentially impact the way that Saudis live their lives. I mean, from the money they make to the how much money they pay for electricity and water and power and other issues. So that's a huge issue. Everybody's involved in it. The government is actually seeking feedback. There are channels that allow the various ministries to change the policies and to evaluate the different programs, getting some feedback from customers and experts in various areas. So I think this impacts everybody. And then they also have, I think, their hands full with the war in Yemen and Syria is another issue. So. You know, just as, again, I don't want to dismiss it or minimize it. It's an issue of great concern. But if there's a way for that, I have no doubt, obviously, the Saudis would like it to go away as soon as possible. But, you know, that it's not very likely at this point. It also raises a question as to, you know, this will obviously go on. It will not be resolved anytime soon. So the question is, how does the next administration handle it? You know, that's a big question, and the elephant in the room, so to speak.
Yeah. My own sense is that actually the Saudi leadership has behaved as if it. Well, firstly, I think the Saudi leadership didn't think it would ever happen because no one would dare tamper with the doctrine of sovereign immunity.
Yeah.
They never thought that the Americans would be crazy enough to do that.
Yeah.
Anyway, so they behaved as if, you know, this wasn't going to happen. Mm. So, you know, in the summer you had a $3.5 billion investment in Uber.
Right.
Right now, the Saudi Arabia has gotten involved in a big venture capital investment that would invest in the United States. You know, they've acted and behaved as if JASTA doesn't exist and it doesn't affect them at all. And they're constantly sending people here to look at investments here, but also attracting U.S. investments to the kingdom as part of the Vision 2030 program. So, you know, I mean, one could call it being in denial. Another way to put it is to think that they don't really think it will ever have significant teeth.
Yeah, fair enough. All right, so we're going to go to you, and then to you, and then you, and then we'll come back over here. So, first row.
Yeah, hi. My name is Faisal Huwain. I'm from the Saudi Political Science Association. My question for Mr. Fahad and Professor Haykel about the soft power. Do you agree with that Saudi Arabia has like a lack in using its soft power. And what I mean by soft power, that the Saudis doing very well when it comes to formal governmental like meetings and discussions, the king with the president or like the foreign minister with the secretary of state. But there's a huge gap between the two nations. I mean, we have, let's say, more than 350 clubs, Saudi clubs, in, like, around, like in all the universities and all states. But the, I mean, we don't get anything from that, I mean, politically.
Yeah.
And just one of the results of that.
Okay.
So no, do you agree with that?
So our public diplomacy?
Yeah, public diplomacy.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, I do think that, as I said earlier in my remarks, that Saudi Arabia has not done public diplomacy. And, you know, I mean, there are hundreds of thousands of Saudis who studied in this country, as you know, and who know this country well and who love this country and, you know, et cetera. And I don't see them being used at all.
Mm.
So I think, you know, there's a lot that can be done, absolutely.
Mm. Yeah, so do I. Fahad?
Yeah, I mean, I agree. And I think, again, based on my conversations with the Saudi friends and colleagues and others, yeah, it seems that a consensus has emerged that that there is a Saudi Arabia does have an image problem in the West in general, but I think in the United States more specifically. I think Foreign Minister Adel Jaber himself at some point during an interview, I want to say, with BBC last year, did acknowledge that there is a problem, and I think he didn't take, you know, personal responsibility, but he said the government overall is not doing a good enough job of telling their side of the story. I believe that Gallup did a poll not long ago, and I think Saudi Arabia scores fairly low among the respondents was here in the U.S., with, I want to say, China and Russia scoring higher. Now, this was about a year ago. I'm not sure how well Russia would fare at this point.
Not well.
But it's something worth keeping in mind.
Mm. So, David, there's this. There was some resistance to your idea of a Saudi-led commission. I mean, is there what are the prospects for successful public diplomacy? I mean, is there a receptive audience in the United States? Is there a you think Americans are really willing to listen? If the message is receivable one?
To what part of the story?
Well, to in general, to Saudi Arabia, the Saudi government, improving the general impression that ordinary Americans have, or even American opinion leaders have.
So, look, I'm very involved in Republican Party politics.
Yeah.
And so we're about to have another kicking administered to us.
Yeah.
And when Republicans get together to talk about our problems, the metaphor that is used again and again is the problem the pizza or is the problem the pizza box?
Yeah.
And what we have, for 7 years now, the general, I have been an outlier on this, but the consensus has been pizza's great.
Yeah.
The pizza box could use some redesigning. I think beginning in November, we're going to have Republicans saying, oh, there maybe the rat poison in the crust is also is also an issue that should be, we should have. Okay, so I would say that's a universal challenge of communications.
Yeah.
Is Saudi Arabia's problem the pizza box or is it the pizza?
Mm-hmm.
And there are gaps. I mean, a lot of Saudis come to the United States and like it.
Mm-hmm.
A lot of Americans go to Saudi Arabia, they don't like it so well.
Mm.
There's no question, before the attacks of 2005, there are real questions about how forthcoming Saudi Arabia was.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, it's one thing if in 2002 a government says, we discovered this businessman in one of the towns who was giving money to this terrorist organization, and we've caught him, and we've arrested him, and we're trying him in our courts, and you know we're fully cooperating with the FBI in this matter. It's another if you protect him for 3 years until there's a terrorist attack on your own soil.
Mm.
So there are some real problems. So that one of the reasons I suggested this, and maybe it's a terrible idea, as I say, I don't know Saudi Arabia well. I've never been there, but I would think, as you think about this question, think about the pizza and the box.
No, it's a great analogy, and it's a rich one. So we're going to go over here to the lady first, and then the gentleman behind, and then we'll back.
Hi, thank you so much. I'm Rebecca, and I'm from Georgetown University.
A little louder.
Sure. This might be a very basic question. I'm also not a lawyer.
Don't worry.
It's two questions, I guess. In terms of enforcement jurisdiction, I can't really see how a court could even hear a case like this. I know that you said that the problem was with the discovery and not necessarily.
Well, it begins with discovery and then downhill from there. But my point was you don't have to go to verdict and damages before there's a diplomatic crisis. That's my point. It just gets worse and worse as the process goes along.
So I guess my question is, would the process go along because there doesn't seem to be a basis for enforcement jurisdiction here?
Okay.
And my second question is in regard to your remark about a subpoena. My understanding is that while the U.S. would be able to summon a U.S. citizen residing abroad for a subpoena and seize their assets if they were to fail to show up, we don't have the authority to do that for a Saudi national or for somebody else. But again, I'm not a lawyer. Thanks.
Well, luckily, David here is. But also, just let me say, I mean, even if, say, Professor Haykel's scenario about summoning the king to testify is practically not an issue in reality.
I wouldn't put it beyond the lawyers.
I wouldn't either,
yeah.
But let's just say it is. At a minimum, you would have a series of interrogatories put before, say, the Saudi government, which would be sworn statements about all kinds of things, and request for the discovery of all kinds of documents that reveal not only classified information, but sources and methods, names of informants, all kinds of stuff that would never be handed over, would result in a summary judgment, and then you'd shoot right past trial directly into damages. And as I was saying, they would have to be, if they're going to be punitive, they have to be proportionate, and then you're talking about gigantic sums. The whole thing is, the nightmare that comes out of Pandora's box is pretty scary once the pretty shield is taken off. So, David, did you want to talk about enforcement jurisdiction?
Yeah, you know, I don't know enough about this because it's such a new thing, because we've always believed you couldn't do it.
Right, yeah.
You couldn't do it.
That's right.
But let me pick up something that Hussein said about
Please.
What is revealed by these discovery methods. So
yeah.
when the Pentagon Papers were revealed in 1970 or 71, mm-hmm. You look back on it now and say, why was this so exciting? What was here that actually people did not already know in 1970 or 71? And the answer is there wasn't that much.
There
were a series of minor revelations
right.
that had huge repercussions outside. One I wrote something about this. And it turned out that the Swedes, who had an embassy in North Vietnam,
mm.
had been acting as a de facto American intelligence gathering entity inside North Vietnam, and had been finding out information about American prisoners of war, and had been playing a very helpful part.
Mm.
And they'd been doing all of this while taking in international forums an aggressively neutralist position on the Vietnam War.
True.
So there was we've all heard about the differences between public and private, and how how shocking and unthinkable it is that you might have a different one view in a public forum and a different view in the privacy of your own brain. But that's what happened to the Swedes. And it had huge repercussions on Swedish domestic politics. It pushed Sweden actually away from the United States
mm-hmm.
because it had to reestablish that the public position was the authentic one, not the private one.
Right.
And it took us 20 years to fully complete the reintegration of Sweden as what it always had been, a fully cooperative member of the Western Alliance, in fact, if not in name.
Mm.
There are all kinds of things like that. I mean, if you ever were to get access to the Saudi files, I'm sure there are things that are highly embarrassing to the Saudi government in ways that reveal that they were actually a better friend than back at home they ever wanted to admit to being.
Right. That might be things very embarrassing to the United States or other governments as well.
Exactly.
Yeah, so it's endless problems. The gentleman here.
George Abed is my name. Hussein, I want to pick up on a point you mentioned in your introductory remarks, because that point, if it's important, then further discussion takes a different color. the point about the buyer's remorse of the 28 senators who wrote a letter, to write a letter and express that view after they had already voted to override the veto, tells me that they really feel strong about it and they're not just going to go away, and there may be more support for that point of view post November 8th.
Yeah.
So the question is, and I would like the speakers to speculate on it, will anything happen as a result of that or as a signal coming from this group of senators to perhaps either modify, adjust, provide a waiver for the president, other things that would actually make all the discussions we've had here perhaps not quite so critical. I'm just curious whether David and others can reflect on the legislative process in the interim period between the election date and January 20th.
Yeah, I mean, let's think about a legislative fix and what it might look like. Let me just say, before we get into this, my understanding is that from what I've heard from the Hill and this whole process, is that the one thing that's really not on the table at this point, and it could change, is the implementation, is the obvious solution, which is the reintroduction of the executive waiver. I mean, that would be the simplest, easiest, quickest, most normative, standard way of doing this. But as far as I understand it, that's actually not on the table. And the fixes that I've heard about are much more arcane and roundabout than that sort of curative. But do you have any thoughts about this? No? David, what do you think?
I don't know this area well. Mm-hmm. And this question about it's almost a discussion you want to postpone for 90 days.
Yes.
Because Congress may look, it will certainly look a little different. It may look a lot
different.
May look
very different, yeah.
There's going to be a very interesting question of whether President Hillary Clinton will be a president who plays better with Congress, worse with Congress, and the same. The relationship between President Obama and Congress got pretty frayed. And we don't want to take sides. He was just as sick of them as they were of him.
Definitely.
Hillary Clinton doesn't have a reputation as somebody who works well with people who disagree with her, but that may be unfair. And we're all about, very likely we're all about to learn. And we'll see if it's a priority for her, if she wants to reassert this. And the way to reassert it, if you were the president, is this is not about Saudi Arabia. It's about president. I mean, that's why, I was surprised that this had the result it did. This is about presidential power.
Mm-hmm.
This is about the right of the president to conduct foreign affairs as the president thinks right. And that is a constitutional responsibility of the president, and it shouldn't be delegated to courts.
Right. Without telling tales out of school, let me just say that I have a personal knowledge that makes me, that convinces me to a moral certainty that for some reason the administration did not make the requisite efforts to give its supporters in the House, for example, full and complete understanding of the reasons why they should have voted with the White House on this. How and why that was the case, I don't know, but I'm just sure that it is the case, and that's quite remarkable. And so you could certainly have a more aggressive approach after the election by a Clinton White House on this issue than you had. For some reason, President Obama seems to have felt this was important, but he didn't play all his cards at all. That's for sure.
Yeah, I mean, it seems to me that maybe one of the complicating factors was the fact that most of the opposition was coming from Republican members and leadership in Congress, beginning with the Speaker Paul Ryan and others who've always had reservations. So one would assume that factored into President Obama's approach, just because, that most of the opposition, I think the more vocal members have been Republicans for the most part.
Well, all he needed was a decent chunk of his own members in the Senate to sustain the veto. He could have forgotten about the House entirely and gotten, 28 members of the Senate would do it, I think. Mm-hmm. He got one. and that's someone who's retiring. And yeah,
it's a start.
So you, well, it's not really a start because you need a 28. I am just sure that they did not treat this the way they would a challenge to, say, the Trans-Pacific Partnership or the climate.
Or the Iran deal.
Or the Iran deal, exactly, or the Iran deal. I think you would have seen a different level of engagement on a challenge to those issues.
Right, and I think this goes back to my initial remarks, Hussein, when I said that in the eyes of certainly some Saudis, this is a pattern that has been, for much of President Obama's presidency, is that things have gotten from bad to worse. I think that's the way that many Saudis have seen it, and they did not, in the opinion pieces that I've read, they didn't, the domestic politics angle of the equation was almost overlooked completely,
right.
And the blame, for the most part, I think, seems to have gone to President Obama, because he does have this rather unfavorable view among and legacy among many Saudis.
Well, where it was considered, it was misconstrued in the extreme. Mm-hmm. So, for example, like the one not prominent but known Saudi columnist who thought it was a Jewish plot, basically, and an Israeli-inspired Jewish plot, which is clearly wrong, since Israel is about as alarmed as any other state about this legislation. And sovereign immunity, you could hardly find a country that cling to that principle more vociferously than Israel would.
Can I add one point?
Please
This is a slight tangent.
Okay.
I mean, in as much as this legislation and its reversal has anything to do with Saudi Arabia's image and reputation in this country, and given that it's very, very likely that the next president of the United States is going to be a woman, there is one thing Saudi Arabia can do that would immediately place it in the normal category of countries, which is to allow its women to drive.
Mm-hmm.
If it did that,
it would
instantly make it seem a lot more normal and less of the aberration that it is in the eyes of so many Americans.
There's no
or
question.
Take advantage of the $2.5 billion Uber investment and ban them in.
Self-driving
only
cars.
Robots.
Self-driving cars only. No, but I think it's funny.
Because
but
I'm sure
I think
that
you're right.
I'm sure that President Clinton is going to be harping on the issue of women from day one.
Well, I think raising the subject, I would say. But yeah, I mean, but I take your point. It is that kind of gesture would have a tremendous impact in the United States. Let me just say, apropos of your question, the kind of fix that could be available, but what I would want to see them do is restore a binding executive waiver like all other similar legislation has that would restore the normal balance of the separation of powers in the approved constitutional manner. Assuming we're not going to get that, one of the things that could be done is some sort of legislation that would limit the nature and scope of the lawsuits to those that have been filed by a certain date, or those that refer to a limited set of events. And you could find a version of that that I think the Saudi government could live with, and that could be packaged as giving the 9/11 families their day in court and stuff like that, that would be all right. I think that's achievable. So think in those terms, all right?
I think that you get just non-jury trials.
Mm-hmm.
And I think you get no punitive damages. But JASTA may have fixed that, but
well,
I didn't.
Why do you think you get no punitive damages in these cases?
Because in the standard Foreign Sovereign Immunities Act case, you don't get punitive damages unless JASTA changed that. And I
think it did. I think that the sponsors of JASTA are hoping and assuming that there'll be punitive damages. They talk
right, well,
as if there
I'm
would
wrong.
Be.
Okay, well, but
well,
okay.
I don't know either. Well,
I don't
none
know.
Of us know because it hasn't gone to the damages part of any trial, so we don't know.
My thought is, why doesn't Saudi Arabia suggest that we bring this to an international court?
Okay.
Then you wouldn't have American discovery. Yeah. You'd have like if you if you, you might have discovery like you have in civil countries.
Yeah.
You would also have, generally speaking, in a civil country, if you lose, you have to pay the other guy's lawyer.
Right.
And maybe it wouldn't be so much activity.
No, it's a good question. Let me just say, I'm not sure Senator Schumer and his colleagues would embrace that. I think they might have a hard time convincing them that anything other than a U.S. court would be satisfactory. But what about that idea?
Well, I mean, who would the Saudis negotiate that with? You know, I mean,
well, it would have to be Congress, you know, I guess.
I mean, I don't, it's an interesting idea, but I don't know how you would put it into effect, yeah, given, yeah, that Congress is so determined to actually have this tried here in the United States.
Well, we'll see how determined they are after the election. They may mellow, but we'll see. Any thoughts on this idea?
Yeah, I think it's unlikely, and His Highness Prince Turki said as much. And you detected that from what he said. It. He actually, I think, at some point said, I'm angry at the legislation. So there is anger and frustration, and I think that will prevent the Saudi government from agreeing to anything like that.
Okay, because so again, politically difficult.
They think this is an open and shut case that has been thoroughly investigated, and I think that's their position, and I don't see that changing anytime soon.
Okay.
Amal Mudallali, my question is for Mr. Frum. Secretary Clinton said after JASTA was passed that she will sign it into a law if she becomes president. Talking about the amendments that people are working on now and stuff like that, if this effort fails in the lame duck, do you think Clinton would, and forget that you are Republican, that Secretary Clinton or potential President Clinton could use her presidential powers to do something, and can she do something? Can a president using presidential authority to do something?
Well, again, this is taking me way beyond my depths here. But presidents are normally very protective of mm-hmm. presidential powers. And I would imagine that Hillary Clinton will be like her predecessors, that she will want to maximize the power of the presidency. On the other hand, she told us in the third debate, I mean, if what she says is true, she is going to be plunged into a series of tremendous fights with Congress almost immediately.
Oh,
she wants to raise taxes right away. She said in the third debate that within the first 100 days she would return to the immigration debate. That's the most contentious issue in society. This would be a difficult fight for a new president. And one of the things that is sort of weird about this story is this is a classic fight in which an eighth-year president should be stronger than a first-year president.
Absolutely. Isn't it?
Because the eighth-year president, I'm just not going to pass over the... I'm very likely passing over this office to a successor of my own party, somebody I've worked strongly for, and it's important to me that the powers I pass on be in no way diminished from those that I receive from my predecessor. That's something that an eighth-year... For a first-year president, they have actual big domestic agenda items they want to pass, and then they are going to want to act strategically, choose their fights carefully.
Let me add something on this. I'm not a constitutional attorney or anything like that, but I can't see what an executive order or other presidential prerogative could do to get around the statutory power of JASTA, because it's certainly gone into law, and it says very clearly the courts shall have exclusive jurisdiction over these matters. That's part of the language of the law. And then it lays out exactly what the executive can and cannot do. And let me explicate that for everybody here. It says that the Secretary of State can request a stay on any lawsuit by certifying that there are good faith discussions going on with the foreign country in question. Now, the court may, and this is the language of JASTA, the court may grant that stay. Implicitly, the court may not. That's why we speak about there being a lack of a binding executive waiver on this. Okay? So that what you would have expected from, say, more normative legislation of this kind is, say, that the Secretary of State or the President can do this, and the court shall grant it, right? But it doesn't say that. It says they may grant it. So that means a court could turn down a request. However, once a stay has been issued, it will last for 180 days, and then the Attorney General can request an extension of that stay based on recertification of good faith discussions, and in that case, the court shall grant it, and then that goes on for any number of 180-day periods. So basically, what the Congress has set up is a situation where when the issue comes before a court, the court and therefore the judicial branch gets to decide whether it wants to keep it and tell the administration, the executive, to go away and leave them alone and keep that power, or give it back to the executive. Once they do that, it stays with the executive. It doesn't bump back and forth. The executive keeps it for 180 days, but they can keep renewing it. The court doesn't have the prerogative of taking that issue back. It stays with the executive as long as the executive wants to hold on to it. But the point is, the court can say no in the outset and not grant the stay, and the administration will have no role in this. And I just don't see what. Maybe there's a smart constitutional lawyer who can tell us, but I can't think of anything constitutionally that a president could do to get around that, given the extremely explicit language of JASTA and saying the court shall have exclusive jurisdiction over this, and then going into those potential exceptions that are not binding. I think we may have wrapped up this discussion, so I'd like to ask our panelists for final thoughts. Where do we go from here? And how bad is this situation, and how can it be resolved? I'll begin with you, Professor Haykel.
It is basically speculation where it's going to. We're going to see with the lame duck Congress whether there's going to be any dilution of this bill. Who the next president is going to be, but I'm fairly confident that the relationship between the United States and Saudi Arabia is a strong one, because it is not based on sentiments.
No.
And nor is it based on very hard and crude, forgive the pun, facts to do with just the amount of oil that the country has and can produce, its location in the world, its the stability of that country for the global order and for American interests. And a hard-nosed realist, an American hard-nosed realist, I think would realize this very quickly and would know that this relationship is fundamental to the security interests of the United States.
A refined relationship based on crude facts.
Yes.
Okay, good. Fahad, let's go down the line and do David.
I'd like to recommend a movie, if you haven't already seen it, called Eye in the Sky, in which Helen Mirren plays a British Air Force officer who's trying to drone a terrorist suspect. And the obstacle is the tissue of legal restrictions that have been placed on members of the military. And it's a microcosm of something that is just more and more true of international relations, which was this project of legalizing and judicializing things that are inescapably political. So I encourage everyone to think about today's problem in a broader context.
Yeah.
This is not just about U.S.-Saudi relations. That's one context to think about. But another context is to say, how are foreign relations done? Where do they belong? Do they belong in courts, or do they belong in chanceries? And once you see that part of the problem, then you realize we have a very big problem indeed. It binds militaries. It is centered on the International Criminal Court, and there is a lot. If you decide that it's important to put the politics back in international politics, then there's a lot of unwinding that has to be done, not just this particular bill.
Fahad?
I agree with Professor Haykel. I think that relationship will survive. But at the same time, I think that given the pervasiveness of satellite television in Saudi Arabia and social media, Saudis are paying very close attention to the elections. Frankly, the prevailing sentiment, at least according according to my reading, is that almost either Secretary Clinton or Mr. Trump will be a better option than President Obama. I think that seems to be the prevailing sentiment among many Saudis. They're looking forward to maybe turning a new page. I don't think that prospect of Secretary Clinton becoming president excites many people, although some women's rights advocates are excited by that. But generally speaking, Saudis are not terribly excited. On the other hand, I think Trump is obviously a possibility, or the prospect of a Trump presidency makes certainly a segment of Saudis nervous, and I think understandably so. Mm-hmm.
All right. Well, ladies and gentlemen, please join me in thanking our panel. I think this is an excellent conversation. We appreciate it.